Acts chapter 24. Acts 24 and verse 25. And as he reasoned of righteousness, temperance, and judgment to come, Felix trembled and answered, "Go thy way for this time. When I have a convenient season, I will call for thee." We're going to be in chapter 25 this evening, but we're going to be expounding and expanding upon this 25th verse of chapter 24 with special reference to the last word, the last thing that Paul was reasoning with Felix about, and that is judgment. We saw, if you'll first of all turn back to John 16, where we saw this remarkable parallelism between what Jesus had said that the Holy Spirit's ministry would be whenever Jesus ascended and sent the Comforter back to the earth in John chapter 16, verses 8 through 11. Between this and what we just read there in verse 25 of these three things, Paul is reasoning with Felix about righteousness, temperance, or sin, and judgment. John 16 and verse 8. Well, we better go back up to verse 7. John 16 and verse 7, "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you, but if I depart, I will send him unto you." Well, go back over to chapter 14 before you finish reading those verses. I just thought of another verse over here. Well, what we just read there in John 16:7, "When I go away," he says, "I'll send the Comforter unto you, but if I depart, I will send him unto you." Now, it's interesting that the Holy Spirit's not sent unto the world there. He's not sent unto lost people. He's sent unto believers there. And look what Jesus said in John 14. This was the verse I was thinking of. John 14 and verse 15. "If ye love me, keep my commandments. And I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another Comforter, that he may abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive. Because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but ye know him. For he dwelleth with you, and shall be in you." Now going back to John 16, we see the Holy Spirit's not sent out there to the world. The Holy Spirit is sent to the believer. We're going to be talking tonight about judging ourselves before the time. The Holy Spirit is sent to the believer that the believer might judge himself before the time. And what time do you think the time is? That's the final time where we are all going to be judged. And the Bible says it's best that you judge yourself before that time, lest you be judged. John 16, 8, "And when he has come, he will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. Of sin, because they believe not on me. Of righteousness, because I go to my Father, and ye see me no more. Of judgment, because the prince of this world is judged." Now, what we had said in the message last week on John 16, verse 11, where he mentions the judgment of the prince of this world, if you'll turn to Jude, the verse we saw in Jude in verse 6, "The judgment of the prince of this world and of the princes," plural, "of this world," that is Satan's demons and fallen angels and all that make up and comprise the kingdom of darkness, "the judgment of all these spiritual entities is merely but a type of the judgment that is going to come upon all people, both saved and unsaved alike, the latter days." Jude in verse 6. "The angels which kept not their first estate, but left their own habitation, he hath reserved in everlasting chains under darkness unto the judgment of the great day." Now all these, of course, these judgments aren't going to take place on the same literal day, a 24-hour day, but we're talking about the day of the Lord. And that is end time events in eschatology. And so we'll see all of these judgments coming to pass and coming about in the day of the Lord. You're going to have a judgment of everything, a judgment of all people, of all fallen angels and demons, the devil, whether the people are still alive, whether the people are now dead, whether they were saved or unsaved, or whether they're saved or unsaved at the moment they're being judged, if they've not died before that. Regardless of what state they're in, we're still going to see a judgment come. And no wonder that whenever Paul is speaking with Felix of these things, then Felix is trembling. Because all we have is these three words recorded in Acts 24, 25, righteousness, temperance, and judgment. But he didn't say righteousness, temperance, and judgment to Felix. He reasoned with him about these things. And we simply have these three words written down to give us a summation of what Paul must have said to poor Felix, shaking in his boots there. But Paul must have said a lot of things to the man, because he was trembling there under fear and under conviction for what Paul was saying. Now, the reason we're going to take a look at the subject of judgment is because this is a word that's peculiar to Acts 25. You see it seven times here, just in chapter 25, the word judgment or judgment seat. Acts 25 and verse 1. Now when Festus, we just discovered Porcius Festus in the last verse of chapter 24. Now when Festus was come into the province, after 3 days, he ascended from Caesarea to Jerusalem. There we go again with that Near Eastern geography. He didn't ascend, he descended. Then the high priest and the chief of the Jews informed him against Paul and besought him, desired favor against him, that he would send for him to Jerusalem, laying wait in the way to kill him. But Festus answered that Paul should be kept at Caesarea, that he himself would depart shortly thither. Let them therefore, said he, which among you are able, go up with me, and accuse this man, if there be any wickedness in him. When he had tarried among them more than 10 days, he went down, up to Caesarea. The next day, sitting on the judgment seat, commanded Paul to be brought. Now, there's the first time we see judgment. It's just peculiar to this chapter, 27 verses. Seven times we already see this subject of judgment being mentioned. When he was come, the Jews came, we'll go ahead the way they've got it, down from Jerusalem, stood round about and laid many and grievous complaints against Paul, this pestilent fellow, which they could not prove. While he answered for himself, neither against the law of the Jews, neither against the temple, nor yet against Caesar, have I offended anything at all. But Festus, willing to show the Jews a pleasure, answered Paul and said, wilt thou go up to Jerusalem and there be judged of these things before me? Then said Paul, I stand at Caesar's judgment seat, where I ought to be judged. To the Jews have I done no wrong, as thou very well knowest. For if I be an offender or have committed anything worthy of death, I refuse not to die. But if there be none of these things whereof they accuse me, no man may deliver me unto them. I appeal unto Caesar. Then Festus, when he had conferred with the council, answered, hast thou appealed unto Caesar? Then unto Caesar shalt thou go. So the first 12 verses is one division. This is Paul's defense before Festus. Now verses 13 through 27, we have an introduction of King Agrippa, who we'll be looking at in chapter 26. Well, this is all Paul has said so far here before Festus, the first 12 verses. Then beginning with verse 13, you see already a mention of King Agrippa and Bernice, who have also come to Caesarea, where Paul is located. Well, it's interesting that now that we've got for a second time here, someone in verse 3 wanting to lay wait and kill Paul. I rather doubt it's those fellows who had that oath that they wouldn't eat or drink until they got him, because this is some time later now. They'd be rather small by now. And I rather doubt they could do much damage to Brother Paul should they catch him in the first place. But he could probably outrun all 40 of them together now, because they'd be rather thin. But we've got a group of people now after dear Paul's life. I wonder where he's sinned this time. Because here we've got someone trying to kill him all over again. Of course, they want him. He's up in Caesarea now. This is where he's been for 2 years with Felix the Trembler. And these people want Porcius Festus now to go up there to Caesarea and fetch Paul back and bring him back to Jerusalem, because, of course, they want to kill him on the way back. So, verse 4, Festus answered that Paul should be kept at Caesarea, that he himself would depart shortly thither. He said, I'm going to Caesarea myself. In verse 5, he said, if there's any among you who are able and want to accuse Paul, then you can go along with me. Verse 6, and when he tarried among them more than 10 days, he went down or up to Caesarea. The next day, sitting on the judgment seat, commanded Paul to be brought. When he was come, the Jews, which came up from Jerusalem, stood round about and laid many and grievous complaints against Paul, which they could not prove. Now, don't have a cardiac arrest, because we keep changing the words up and down and ascend and descend. It's just that that's a little different terminology. I'm just trying to paint the picture in your mind so you know that Caesarea is north and not south of Jerusalem. But they're always, seems to do everything backwards there. They sing, come up to Jerusalem, when they're already up from Jerusalem. Now, if you look back in chapter 24 in verse 5, have you ever been called either one of these three things here? This is what they think of Paul, and now they're having a second opportunity to accuse him. This is, of course, the hired Tertullius speaking here. For we have found this man a pestilent fellow, and a mover of sedition among all the Jews throughout the world, and a ringleader of the sect of the Nazarenes. Now, we've got this same group of people anyway over here in verse 7 of chapter 25. When he was come, the Jews which came up from Jerusalem stood round about and laid many and grievous complaints against Paul, which they could not prove. While he answered for himself, neither against the law of the Jews, neither against the temple, nor yet against Caesar, have I offended anything at all. But Festus, willing to show the Jews a pleasure, this is the same thing said of Felix in the earlier chapter. It says that Felix, willing to show the Jews a pleasure, left Paul bound for 2 years. So Festus is the same way in this regard, wanting to show the Jews a pleasure, answered Paul and said, wilt thou go down to Jerusalem and there be judged of these things before me? Now, this is something that would be rather common for these leaders like Festus and Felix to do to the Jews, because the Jews in the first place don't like the Romans who are lording over them. So any opportunity that a Roman leader like Felix or Festus would get to somehow appease or placate the wrath of the Jews against them, well, they're going to jump at that opportunity, even if it meant to the harm or the degradation of someone like the Apostle Paul. Because in verse 10, Paul says, I stand at Caesar's judgment seat, where I ought to be judged. To the Jews I've done no wrong, as thou very well knowest. You see, just like with Jesus' trial, Pilate and Herod knew that he was innocent of anything that was worthy of death. The same is true here with the Apostle Paul. They know that he's innocent of anything that would put him to death if he were charged and judged for it. For if I be an offender or have committed anything worthy of death, I refuse not to die. But if there be none of these things whereof they accuse me, no man may deliver me unto them. And then here's Paul's famous statement, I appeal unto Caesar. Now, I guess you realize that that one statement there is another statement that some of our charismatic kinsmen jump on for Paul missing it, because that one statement brings Paul's death in the long run. We'll see this in the next chapter. If he wouldn't have made that statement, then he wouldn't have been brought before Caesar and end up executed in the long run. This is what we read clearly over in chapter 26. So Paul, making this one statement here, he doesn't realize it at that time, and nor does anyone else who hears what he's saying, and nor do you unless you've read ahead in chapter 26. That statement means Paul's death. I appeal unto Caesar. Then Festus, when he had conferred with the council, answered, Hast thou appealed unto Caesar? Then unto Caesar shalt thou go. Now, of course, the Caesar is the top in the Roman government, and for that, Paul would have to travel back to Rome. Now we pick up verses 13 through 27. We have the introduction of King Agrippa and Bernice. And after certain days, King Agrippa and Bernice came unto Caesarea to salute Festus. When they had been there many days, Festus declared Paul's cause unto the king, saying, There is a certain man left in bonds by Felix, about whom when I was at Jerusalem, the chief priests and the elders of the Jews informed me, desiring to have judgment, and there's that word again, against him. To whom I answered, It is not the manner of the Romans to deliver any man to die before that he is accused before the accusers face to face, and have license to answer for himself concerning the crime laid against him. Therefore, when they were come hither without any delay, on the morrow I sat on the judgment seat and commanded the man to be brought forth. Against whom, when the accusers stood up, they brought none accusation of such things as I supposed. He thought that they were, you know, going to bring some charge that Paul had robbed a bank or something that was worthy of them bringing him before them. But he said, it wasn't a charge that I thought, but they had certain questions against him of their own superstition, and of one Jesus, which was dead, whom Paul affirmed to be alive. Because I doubted of such manner of questions, I asked him whether he would go to Jerusalem and there be judged of these matters. But when Paul had appealed to be reserved unto the hearing of Augustus, I commanded him to be kept till I might send him to Caesar. And this was the Caesar's name, Augustus Caesar. Then Agrippa said unto Festus, I would also hear the man myself. It's like they're playing cat and mouse with Paul, and every time a new fella comes in town, he wants to be entertained by Paul's defense. So every time a new fella comes in town, they put Paul back up on the judgment stand, and he's got to give a defense again. So Festus says, Tomorrow thou shalt hear him. And on the morrow, when Agrippa was come, and Bernice, with great pomp, was entered into the place of hearing with the chief captains and principal men of the city, at Festus' commandment, Paul was brought forth. And Festus said, King Agrippa, and all men which are here present with us, ye see this man about whom all the multitude of the Jews have dealt with me, both at Jerusalem and also here, crying that he ought not to live any longer. But when I found that he had committed nothing worthy of death, and that he himself had appealed to Augustus, I had determined to send him, of whom I have no certain thing to write unto my Lord. Wherefore I have brought him before you, and specially before thee, O King Agrippa, that after examination had, I might have somewhat to write. For it seemeth to me unreasonable to send a prisoner, and not withal to signify the crimes laid against him. Well, it's very interesting here about poor Festus. Festus is very unknowledgeable when it comes to Christianity and when it comes to the Jews. He is very unknowledgeable. Now, Felix is very knowledgeable, and so is King Agrippa. So in chapter 24, you need to remember this, that Felix is knowledgeable about Christianity and about the Jews. Chapter 25, Festus doesn't know anything that's going on. He's not heard of all this superstition. Chapter 26, Agrippa knows very well about Christianity, and he knows very well about the Jews and their faith also. Let me see, I think I've got some verses for that. Yeah, Felix in 24 and 22 shows that Felix knows what's going on. You see, what Festus is doing in those last two verses, he doesn't know anything about Paul or what he's done wrong. He knows that they are accusing him of talking about some man named Jesus that rose from the dead, but that's about the extent of his understanding of the crimes, alleged crimes, that have been committed by the Apostle Paul. And so he brings him to Agrippa, knowing that Agrippa knows and understands these various matters, so that Agrippa can hear what Paul has to say, and then lay some type of charge or crime against Paul just so that Festus can have something to write in a letter and send that to Caesar. Now back in chapter 24 and verse 22. But when Felix heard these things, having more perfect knowledge of that way, he deferred them and said, when Lysias, the chief captain, shall come down, I will know the uttermost of your matter. So you know what the way is that he's talking about here. And Felix said he had more perfect knowledge of that way. So he understands the way. Now in chapter 26, we'll skip ahead. Verse 3, and show you that King Agrippa is also knowledgeable. You know, it kind of makes you feel sorry for Festus stuck in between these two because he doesn't really know what's going on. But Agrippa, in Acts 26:3, this is Paul speaking before him, and he says, especially because I know thee to be expert in all customs and questions which are among the Jews. So that's fairly interesting of King Agrippa to be so knowledgeable. That's Acts 26:3. And verse 26 of the same chapter. Paul is speaking to both Festus and Agrippa now in verse 26. We'll be covering these verses, or some of these verses, I suppose, next time. For the king knoweth of these things, before whom also I speak freely. For I am persuaded that none of these things are hidden from him, for this thing has not been done in a corner. So that shows that he also knows about Christianity. He knows about the Jews, and he also knows about Christianity. But when it comes to chapter 25 and Festus, then we have verses 18 to 20. And verses 26 and 27, which show us that Festus doesn't really know what's taking place. Verse 18. Against whom, when the accusers stood up, they brought none accusation of such things as I supposed. And like I said, he supposed that it would be some great charge laid against Paul. But had certain questions against him of their own superstition, and of one Jesus, which was dead, whom Paul affirmed to be alive. There's the resurrection mentioned again. Verse 20, and because I doubted of such manner of questions, I asked him, would he go up to Jerusalem and be judged of these matters? He doesn't understand. And then in verses 26 and 27, of whom I have no certain thing to write unto my Lord, speaking about Caesar, because he's going to have to send a letter along with Paul to Caesar. Wherefore I have brought him before you, speaking to all the people that are listening to him. Then he turns to Agrippa, and especially before thee, O King Agrippa, that after examination had, I might have somewhat to write. For it seemeth to me unreasonable to send a prisoner, and not withal to signify the crimes laid against him. Well, I would agree that would be a little unreasonable to send him and not have any charges laid against the Apostle Paul. So we see in verse 6, 9, twice in verse 10, verse 15, verse 17, and verse 20, the subject of judgment mentioned. Now with that in mind, then let's begin looking at several things. And we'll start over in 1 Peter 4. Judging ourselves before the time. First Peter 4, verse 12. Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened unto you. But rejoice, inasmuch as ye are partakers of Christ's sufferings, that when his glory shall be revealed, ye may be glad also with exceeding joy. If ye be reproached for the name of Christ, blessed are ye, for the Spirit of glory and of God resteth upon you. On their part he is evil spoken of, but on your part he is glorified. Now he's just speaking of persecution there. But let none of you suffer as a murderer, or as a thief, or as an evildoer, or as a busybody in other men's matters. Now Paul, remember, said, if I've committed anything worthy of death, then I'll die. He said, if I've done anything worthy of death, I'm willing to die. And Peter's writing, if you're going to suffer, then don't suffer wrongfully, but suffer rightfully. Yet if any man suffer as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God on this behalf. And this is the verse we want, verse 17. For the time is come that judgment must begin at the house of God. And if it first begin at us, then what shall the end be of them that obey not the gospel of God? Very interesting. Time is come that judgment must begin at the house of God. That means judgment must begin on believers. And then Peter says, if it first begin at us, then what shall be the end of those who obey not the gospel of God? And if the righteous scarcely be saved, then where shall the ungodly and the sinner appear? Wherefore let them that suffer according to the will of God commit the keeping of their souls to him in well-doing as unto a faithful Creator. Now you see, the church has the notion that she, for some reason, it's not going to be judged. When the Bible says that that's where judgment's going to begin. Not with the sinner, but with the saint at the house of God. And the church and most charismatics have the idea that they somehow are going to be absent whenever that rod is lowered on people. And whenever, as Paul says in Romans 2 and verse 16, speaking of that same day, because he says, in that day, when God shall judge the secrets of men according to my gospel, Romans 2:16. Now that's a fearful and awesome thing to consider, that you think, well, all those people out in the world who have committed all these sins and done all these ungodly things, you would at least think that's where judgment ought to begin. Let's judge the sinners now. I mean, that's common sense, you'd think. Let's start with where judgment needs to be passed on those who have done wrong and consequently need judgment. When the Bible says the converse thing is true, that judgment must begin at the house of God. Now, we're not studying end time judgments now, because we're going to see a verse, if you'll turn to 1 Corinthians 11, that if you want to be safe, you better be judging yourself before that day comes. Because you'll be judged whether it be now or later. You can be rest assured in that. That's the same as income taxes. I can't say death. Some of us will be escaping that. But it's the same as income taxes. You're guaranteed you got to pay income taxes. Well, some churches get to miss that, it seems like. You know, that used to be a saying, there are two things certain, death and taxes. And death still is certain for those who try to escape their taxes. But for those who pay their taxes and believe the whole word, then we've got a possibility of skipping out on the other side, and that is death. But you can be rest assured that whether it be in this life or in the life to come, we're going to have to be judged. And this is why in 1 Corinthians 11, verse 31, this is where I got the title for the message, for if we would judge ourselves, then we should not be judged. Now that does not mean that we're not going to be judged in the final day. Oh, we're going to be judged then. But if you've already judged yourself and you have lined your life up with the Word of God, then although you'll have to stand before the judgment seat, there'll be no sentence passed upon you except, enter thou into the joy of the Lord, thou good and faithful servant. Now that is something that Jesus talks about three times over in the Gospels, and he only talks about that for a particular and specific group of people when he says, well done, thou good and faithful servant, enter thou into the joy of the Lord. Now it looks like these men are going to have to present themselves, first of all, before the Lord in order for him to say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. So you see, they are still going to have to present themselves before the judgment seat of Christ. That's over in Romans 14 and 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 10. All men, Paul said, are going to have to stand before the judgment seat of Christ. But those who have, well, not really prematurely, but ahead of the time, judged themselves to see are they staying in line with the Word of God, will not have a sentence passed upon them at that time. The Lord will simply say to them, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant, enter thou into the joy of the Lord." And that one fault there, the joy of the Lord, will be significant as we study along here this evening. Back to verse 31, 1 Corinthians 11. "For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world." Now, chastisement and the trials that you go through are not necessarily the same thing at all. God may allow a trial as a means of chastisement, but all of your trials, of course, you ought to realize by now, are by no means chastisement. You have trials, you'll have trials as long as you're a human being, regardless of whether you sin or don't sin. So all your trials aren't some type of manifestation of God's displeasure for you in the form of chastisement. Now, they may be used as that. And most of the time in people's lives, whenever they continue to disobey God, this is what all their trials are about. Their chastisement on them to try to open up their eyes and get them to turn back around on the right path. Now, what we are told here, that if we judge ourselves, we'd not be judged. But then in verse 32, "But when we are judged, then God in His mercy is going to have compassion on us and chastise us rather than condemn us with the world." But then I have a question for you. How long is He going to continue to chastise us?
For the continual...
"But if we judge ourselves, we'd not be judged." But then in verse 32, "But when we are judged, then God in His mercy is going to have compassion on us and chastise us rather than condemn us with the world." But then I have a question for you. How long is He going to continue to chastise us? We're back to last week's message. 120 years, 120 days, 120 minutes. How long will He chastise you before He just condemns you with the world? Now, the Bible says that He'll do that. Galatians 5 speaks about falling from grace. You see, I dare not say that anywhere but the North, because you'd get martyred for making a statement like that in the Baptist Bible Belt, that there's any such thing as falling from grace. But the Bible, I know, uses that very terminology twice, once in Hebrews chapter 12 and once in Galatians 5. It says you better watch out lest you fall from grace. We read about Esau over there, that Esau had fallen from grace. And the church teaches you can't fall from grace. Well, that's the same thing, friends, as being condemned with the world. And whenever God chastises us, it's so that we can find out what we've done wrong. No father chastises his son, beats on his son, just for no reason at all. He's got a reason for hitting him. And it does no good to continue to hit him and hit him and hit him if you don't tell him what he did wrong. He'll never learn from that. So God wants you to turn around and find out, now, what did I do wrong to cause this chastisement to come upon me? Now, you can't treat every trial like that. Remember, I've said that before. You can't treat every trial like that and turn around and say, what have I done wrong? Why did this happen to me? But if you are baptized in the Holy Spirit and you're in tune to God and His Spirit and His Word and His love at all, you ought to know when you've done something wrong. You might can't figure out what it is, but you ought to know, I know why this is happening to me. I've missed it somewhere. And then that is the time to turn around and find out what it is you've missed, so that God doesn't have to continue to chastise you and perhaps, in the long run, condemn you with the world. Verse 33, "Wherefore, my brethren, when ye come together to eat, tarry one for another. And if any man hunger, then let him eat at home, that ye come not together unto condemnation, and the rest will I set in order when I come." Well, I won't resist the temptation to make a comment about verse 34 because, of course, I know that we're going to be having a love feast tomorrow, but he's not talking about eating before you come to the love feast there in verse 34. It'd be best not to eat before you came to the love feast, because the purpose is to come and eat and have your fill. He's talking about whenever they've come together to partake of the bread and cup, and they're so hungry that whenever they get through partaking, well, they just go ahead and eat the rest of that loaf of bread and drink that whole bottle of wine that they had there because they're hungry. And he said, you shouldn't be doing things like that. But it's a different matter when you come to the love feast. If there's a leftover loaf of bread, you ought to be trying to eat it anyway. Several of you get on it and work on that loaf of bread that's left over. Well, that brother's getting excited over it. I doubt we'll have too many bottles of wine there that we need to finish off, but whatever we have, we'll work on that tomorrow. Now, let's go back to several of the Psalms that I want to look at, beginning with Psalm 26. Psalm 26. This is just an extension of last week's message now, taking the last word there, judgment. Because you want to judge yourself before the time arrives, because it'll be too late to judge yourself then. But judge yourself now. Now, it's interesting to see what David says, Psalm 26. Judge me, O Lord. Now, you might think that he's contradicting what I just said, but read the next part of the sentence. For I have walked in mine integrity. You see, he's already judged himself and gotten his life straightened up. That's why he can say to the Lord, now, Lord, you can judge me because I've already judged myself. And this is something you want to be able to say at the last day and the last time. Lord, you can judge me because I've already judged myself and I've already lined up with your word. For I have walked in mine integrity. I have trusted also in the Lord. Therefore I shall not slide. And we're going to see him walking in two things. In verse 1, he's walking in his own integrity. And this is the way he ends up in verse 11. Examine me, O Lord, and prove me, and try my reins and my heart, for thy loving kindness is before mine eyes. And secondly, I have walked in thy truth. And you see, you don't see David doing anything wrong here. This is why he can tell the Lord to judge him, because he's already judged himself. I have not sat with vain persons, neither will I go in with dissemblers. I have hated the congregation of evildoers, and will not sit with the wicked. I will wash my hands in innocency, so will I compass thine altar, O Lord, that I may publish with the voice of thanksgiving and tell of all thy wondrous works. Lord, I have loved the habitation of thy house and the place where thine honor dwelleth. Gather not my soul with sinners, nor my life with bloody men, in whose hands is mischief and their right hand is full of bribes. But as for me, I will walk in mine integrity. Redeem me and be merciful unto me. My foot standeth in an even place. In the congregations will I bless the Lord. Now, all the way back at verse 1, he's already confessing that he won't slide there in verse 1. By the time he's gotten through with his confessions in verse 12, he's not sliding, and he said, my foot now is standing in an even place. Now compare that with what we see over in Psalm 94. Psalm 94, and beginning with verse 11. The Lord knoweth the faults of man, that they are vanity. Blessed is the man whom thou chastenest, O Lord, and teachest him out of thy law, that thou mayest give him rest from the days of adversity, until the pit be digged for the wicked. For the Lord will not cast off his people, neither will he forsake his inheritance. But judgment shall return unto righteousness, and all the upright in heart shall follow it. You see, the righteousness is not going to precede the judgment. That would be an impossibility. You first of all got to judge yourself in order for you to later have righteousness follow. That is, follow up on the heels of that judgment that you've judged yourself and saying, now, these things that I've been taught, this that I've learned, that that I've learned, have I done that yet? Because deception is about the next worst form of deception, self-deception, that there could be. And you hear the things, this and this and this, but then you've got to judge yourself now before the last day, because then you will be judged for what you've heard and for what you know. Now that I've heard these things, have I done these things? And to say, well, you know, I haven't gotten around to doing that yet, or I haven't gotten around to doing this yet, or this or that, or this or that, that won't have any weight whatsoever in God's eyes. Because in the last day, he's going to judge you if you don't judge yourself ahead of time. Now, some of these things might, they should make some people upset and get them to look not at everyone else in the body, but look at themselves. But that's the whole purpose for the ministry, to prepare the bride so that the bride will be ready whenever Christ returns for his bride. And so if you feel uncomfortable, then we're back to Felix trembling in Acts 24:25. Because, listen to me, saints, if you don't judge yourself, God will judge you. I mean, he's giving you the opportunity. He said in 1 Corinthians 11, let us judge ourselves so that we won't be judged. And he's giving you the opportunity to judge yourself before the time so that he won't have to judge you at that time. And you ought to be able, well, you're going to have to judge yourself with just as strict a judgment as he will judge you. Because if you leave a little bit of overlapping room there, that's what he'll judge you for in the last day. So what do you think he would tell you? It's all right, son or daughter, if you don't trust me. Now, he would never tell you that. As we heard in the message recently, that's not the question, that's not the statement that should be made, because he's always asking the question, how far will you trust me? That's the question that he's asking, how far will you trust me? Not, it's all right for you not to trust me today. Or it's all right for you not to trust me in that situation, because after all, I understand that's a rather difficult situation in your life. He doesn't give us that right. He doesn't give us that leeway. But he said, judge yourself so that your judgment, there in that verse in Psalm 94, will return unto righteousness in your life. Psalm 32. Look at this entire psalm, 11 verses of Psalm 32. Which is also quoted, part of it, these first two verses over in Romans 4. Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man unto whom the Lord imputeth not iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no guile. When I kept silence, my bones waxed old through my roaring all the day long. Now, without reading on, do you have any idea what he's talking about there? I mean, without reading on, it's a little difficult to know. What is he talking about? When he said, when I kept silent, then my bones waxed old through my roaring all the day long. See, this is what's taking place, I dare say, in some of your life. Your bones are waxing old and you're roaring all the day long. It's because you've kept silence, you've not confessed your sins and forsaken them. And that's what will happen to you. That's why you go through these feelings. I don't feel like that, friend. I just always have the joy of the Lord. And this is what we'll be getting to down here in the last verse. That's what he's going to say to that servant of his, enter thou into the joy of the Lord. You better be prepared for that joy. I mean, there'd be no way I could even explain to you, because I couldn't explain it to myself, what all that one statement means, enter thou into the joy of the Lord. Why didn't he say enter into heaven now, or enter into God's presence now? But he says enter into the joy of the Lord. Well, there's no way you can have joy if your bones are waxing old and you're roaring all the day long. I guess we could have titled it that, Roaring All the Day Long. But no one would know what I meant by that. When I kept silent, my bones waxed old through my roaring all the day long. And people are just roaring and roaring because they've kept silent about their sins and tried to hide them. For day and night thy hand was heavy upon me. My moisture is turned into the drought of summer. Verse 5, now he's going to get out from this roaring in verse 5. I acknowledge my sin unto thee, and mine iniquity have I not hid. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord, and thou forgavest the iniquity of my sin. That's what he means down there in verse 3, when he said, I kept silent about my sin. That's why he starts off in the first two verses with this great rendition about how blessed is the man when his sins are forgiven. Because he had just experienced some times recently when he knew his sins weren't forgiven, and he knew he wasn't too blessed then. And that's why he can write the first two verses, how blessed is that man whose transgressions and sins are forgiven. Because it's a good feeling inside to know that your sins have been forgiven. Now, I'm not talking about they were forgiven you back in 1964 when you walked the aisle for Jesus. I'm not talking about them forgiven back then. What have you done since 1964? Have all those sins been forgiven? What about the ones just yesterday? Have those been forgiven? Or did you commit any yesterday? You weren't supposed to be committing any yesterday. But if you did, had you kept silent about them? Oh, we may not know it. A lot of times we won't know it. We can't see in your innermost being and in your closet what's going on there. But God can see what's going on there, friends. Don't fool yourself, because he's not fooled, nor is the devil fooled. So don't fool yourself. He sees what's going on there, and he won't let you explain it away with some old dead denominational rationalism. Now I want to show you a verse in Proverbs. I think it's Proverbs 28 and verse 13, where God says in Proverbs 28 and 13, he that covereth his sin shall not prosper, but he that confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy. Let's see, Proverbs 28:13. He that covereth his sins shall not prosper, but is confessing them enough? No, but whoso confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy. Blessed is that man that feareth always, but he that hardeneth his heart shall fall into mischief. Look what we get down in verse 15. As a roaring lion and a raging bear, so is the wicked ruler over the poor people. Well, there you've got the wicked compared again to that roaring lion. In verse 1 of 29, he that being often reproved hardeneth his neck shall suddenly be destroyed, and that without remedy. When you've been often reproved for your sins or for your lack of faithfulness and diligence to God and to his word, if you've been often reproved there and you've hardened your neck against that, the Bible says you'll be suddenly destroyed, and that without remedy. The blood won't help you then. The Bible says, and that without remedy. The blood, the name, confession, 1 John 1:9, none of those things will help you then. Proverbs 29:1, he that being often reproved hardeneth his neck shall suddenly be destroyed, and that without remedy. It's like back over in 1 Corinthians 11, where he said that if we would judge ourselves, we wouldn't be judged, but when we're judged, we're chastened of the Lord so that we're not condemned with the world. All right, let's go back to Psalm 32. Read verse 5 again. I acknowledge my sin unto thee, and mine iniquity have I not hid. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord, and thou forgavest the iniquity of my sin. For this shall everyone that is godly pray unto thee, in a time when thou mayest be found. What is the this? It's the back in verse 5. For this shall everyone that is godly pray unto thee in a time when thou mayest be found. Now, do you remember those verses in Isaiah? We'll go back to those verses in Isaiah 55, which we looked at in the last message. Isaiah 55, verses 6 and 7. This shall everyone that is godly pray unto thee in a time when thou mayest be found. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. And let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. Now, what did he say there? Return to God, seek the Lord, confess your sins before him, forsake your unrighteous deeds and evil thoughts, while the Lord may be found. And this is just what he says in Psalm 32. This shall everyone that is godly pray unto thee in a time when thou mayest be found. And that time, as we said in last week's message, is the time whenever conviction is there, and whenever you've suddenly realized what it is that you're doing wrong or that you've done wrong. Then God is there. He can be found then. You don't have to go and pay some priest to repent for you. You don't have to confess to anyone else your sin. Just confess to him your sin. That's when God can be found. He didn't say go find someone else, but try to find where God is and confess your sin. Verse 6, surely in the floods of great waters they shall not come nigh unto him. Well, it's too late then when you've got all your troubles. It'd be too late to confess your sin. You've got too many floods then. Thou art my hiding place. Thou shalt preserve me from trouble. Thou shalt compass me about with songs of deliverance. So while it's important to sing songs on the blood and sing songs about deliverance, David said, you'll compass me about with songs of deliverance. I will instruct thee and teach thee in the way which thou shalt go, and I will guide thee with mine eye. Be not as the horse or as the mule, which have no understanding, whose mouth must be held in with bit and bridle, lest they come near unto thee. Many sorrows shall be to the wicked, but he that trusteth in the Lord, mercy shall compass him about. Now, we don't want to have any mule or horse-headed Christians in verse 9. He said, don't be like the mule and don't be like the horse, where they're rather difficult to teach them to do what you want them to do. Consequently, you have to put a bridle in their mouth. It's like what God says over in the book of Isaiah, in Isaiah chapter 1. Verses 3 and 4, he's speaking of Israel, and he says, the ox knoweth his owner, and the ass his master's crib, but Israel doth not know, my people doth not consider. Ah, sinful nation, a people laden with iniquity, a seed of evildoers, children that are corruptors. He said, they've forsaken the Lord, they've provoked the Holy One of Israel unto anger, and they've gone away backward. Isaiah 1, verses 3 and 4. That's the way Isaiah's great prophecy opens up there, not on a note of glee and dance and joy, but, ah, sinful nation, a people laden with iniquity. I mean, that's the very terminology he uses. Ah, a sinful nation and a people laden with iniquity. And he said, even the ox and the ass have more sense than my people Israel have. Does the horse and mule have more sense than most Christians have? Because God all the time is tugging on that bridle, trying to get them to repent, and they just go fall headlong into their sins anyway. And that horse, you tug too hard on his bridle, and he's not going to keep running that way. He's got enough horse sense to know, I better not run that way anymore. I'm going to get that bridle pulled on me again. But there goes the Christian off in the pasture land, hopping and skipping and leaping, and doesn't know that he's got many sins filling up his pockets, and he shouldn't be skipping around like that. And so God's trying to slow him down on that bridle, just keeps right on running anyway. A mule, he's saying, a horse, he's saying, an ox, an ass, have more sense than God's people, whether they be Christians or whether they be Israel of old. Verse 11, Psalm 32, be glad in the Lord and rejoice, ye righteous, and shout for joy, all ye that are upright in heart. Now those are the only ones that can enter into the joy of the Lord. Those that have confessed their sins and forsaken them ahead of time, and who've already begun practicing this principle of shouting for joy, all ye that are upright in heart, so that they can be part of that group where the Lord says, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord. Now we want to close with the passage in 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Means you've been listening, brother. If it goes that fast, it's been a whole hour. Now, I have to explain something before we get here in 2 Corinthians 3 while you're turning there. Just the other night in our OT intro class, we were talking some about the canon of the Old Testament. And to understand what we're going to be reading here, I'll have to explain just a little bit about what that word canon means, or where exactly we have the origin for that word canon. The word canon, our word that we use, the English word canon, comes from a word that means a reed or a rod. And you see, when you use a word like that, you're going to get a derivative meaning from it. Because a canon, of course, you know what you think of when you think of canon, and it's an entirely different concept completely. And if we didn't know the origin of this word canon, we'd have no idea what it's talking about when it talks about the canon of the Scriptures or the canon of the Old Testament. So you're going to get really several meanings by derivation from this word. So first of all, it means a reed or a rod. That still doesn't help us understand how can you apply that to the word. Then you've got to go, now what is a reed or a rod used for? A reed, it's a 10-foot stick. A reed is used to measure something with. So then we've got our second meaning. This word canon comes from a word that means to measure. Then we've got to go a third step. Now what is that going to have to do with God's word? Everything in there that lines up to the infallible word of God, that measures up to the infallible word of God, makes it part of the canon of Scripture. You have to go all the way back to where you got that word from originally. So it's used as a form of measurement, and this is what the canon of the Bible is. It was a form of measurement to find out, did these books measure up to what they should and to what the other accepted books which had already lined up had already measured to. Now, 2 Corinthians 3 in verse 1. Do we begin again to commend ourselves, or need we, as some others, epistles of commendation to you, or letters of commendation from you? Ye are our epistle, written in our hearts, known and read of all men. For the epistles are what made it into the canon of the New Testament. So you can see what he's saying there. You are our epistle. You are part of our canon because your life has completely lined up with the Word of God. In other words, your life has been measured against God's Word and found out to be measurable by the Word of God. Not that you find out, is it 10 feet long or is it 5 feet, but does it agree? Does your life agree with what's contained in the canon? Then Paul could say of them, or could say of you, then you're our epistle. You're the canon of God's Word. Because you're not only hearing the Word, but because you're doing it and speaking it, and this is why he says you are known and read of all men. Because they have seen what you've said, and they've seen what you've done that's been based upon the Word of God. Now the verse in, well, we'll just turn over one chapter and close with this verse in 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 10. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that every one may receive the things done in his body, according to that which he hath done, whether it be good or bad. So you see, there is the possibility of standing before that judgment seat and receiving judgment only on the things that you've done good, because that's all you've done, are things good. And therefore, it wouldn't be judgment to condemnation. It wouldn't be passing a sentence upon you, but it would be the extension of an invitation to enter thou into the joy of the Lord. So you see, there is the possibility of standing before that judgment seat good, because he said you can stand there and receive the things done in your body, whether they be good or whether they be bad. But if they're bad, then we have verse 11. Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. Because he knows what that terror of God will be. Judgment. And that's Paul not writing to the world now, remember. He's writing to Christians there. The charismatic Christians, matter of fact. And he says, charismatics, you're going to have to stand before the judgment seat of God too. So you better judge yourselves before the time. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.